And welcome back. This is the RPG check. That's a loud sound. Palagina, thank you. We're going to embark on... Let me just make sure it is in the Rusted Wood. I'm pretty sure it is. Harmke. Devil of Caroc wants us to find him. Working in a clearing. Okay. We'll search him out straight away. Now, I'm also wondering where these people are. This will be under tasks. Lainric is also in the Russet Wood. And Longwatch Falls. Oh, so we might come across these Lainric people. Supposedly they're even tougher than the Sisterhood of the Slake Skull and the... what's the other one? The... Oh, what's the name? The Gleaming Society, right. Right, so...
It ever occur to you that maybe those dukes sent you here to screw things up?
It takes a paranoid mind to dream up a scenario where that makes any sense.
Hate to piss on your daisies, but them dukes will sell you out when it suits them.
My life is theirs. I don't question how it will end, so long as it ends in service to the Republics.
Guess it's hard to argue with that. Wow, I missed the little character dialogue.
I'll keep an eye out.
She'll keep an eye out. Right, so I've yet to mess with this character in combat at all. Blinding Strike. This can be very useful. When someone's beating on, say, Aeloth or something, just switch positions with him. Finishing blow. Someone who's weak. Temporarily turn invisible. Withering strike. Extra damage. Dominate. And, of course, we know the knockdown very well. Reckless assault. Many abilities. Alright, so where do you think this guy would be? In a clearing. This place is all clearings. Abandoned camp, hunter's camp. Russellwood Crater. Woodcutter's Grove. Sharp Gallery, and there's the caves. Maybe the grove? A grove
sure.
Is like a clearing of trees, right? Did I miss this? Or are they replanting them after we leave? Been replanted. Hello? Ah, I was right. It's him, Harmke. I remember that weak chin and those knobby knees. She stops, staring motionless at the figures among the trees. Adair says, a weak chin and knobbly knees. Can't be too many people matching that description.
How goes?
The elven man emerges into the clearing and freezes, staring at the Devil of Caroc. For an elf, he's tall and rangy, with a weather-beaten face beneath stringy, greasy hair. The others with him turn, glaring and gaping at the bronze golem.
Auroch's shadow! What's that wicked thing doing here?
Harmke swallows, a lump bobbing in his neck. Okay, so should we allow her to kill him? Or... Not sure. Why are you so nervous?
It's a killer! Look, we don't want no trouble. Just trying to do our work.
Beads of sweat have formed on his forehead despite the chilly air.
We'd be much obliged if you'd leave us be. And take that thing with you.
He looks at the devil with a mixture of terror and loathing. I want her voice in this. Enough! What do you see, Theodas? Is that the man who torched us? The devil sways on her feet, her whole body moving around the axis of her ankles. Though she's... or axles? I don't know. Though she's talking to you, her attention, a concentrated spear of essence, is focused on Harmke. I'd like to read his soul, yeah, but, who are you?
Just a woodcutter. Ask anyone in Stalwart. They'll tell you.
What are you dallying for? See what's written on the bastard's soul. Her essence boils and froths. All right, let's read his soul. He steps away from you, but your awareness reaches through his trembling skin and the feeble resistance of his fear. You see memories. Snowy shrouded forests, partitioned by fallen pines and firs, days measured by the steady swing of your axe. There are other moments, too, recollections that flare up like a hearth's welcoming fire. There are children, spry and lanky like you, but still full of the rowdy energy of youth. Together you scatter winter bloom petals on a grave. You reach deeper into Harmke's soul. Years roll back. A torch in your left hand bathes your face and shoulder in heat. All around you are other men and women holding other torches, and the mountain air is acrid with the stench of smoke and sweat. Rage billows off of the others. It's been a fever in your blood for days now, exhausting you and invigorating you in equal measure. You're at the edge of that town, cold morn. It's hours yet before dawn, but the commotion has started to awaken the village. Candlelight ignites behind frost-crusted windows, and haunted faces peer out at you through the glass. You begin to doubt yourself. Just then, a door slams. A villager comes racing through the trees, kicking up snow. With his stark, white face and pale hair, he looks almost like a ghost. The line of torchbearers ripples as he gets closer. He picks up speed, but nobody moves toward him. You imagine him breaking through the row, shattering your ranks like the bad dream that brought you all here. You imagine waking up in your bed, the heat from your torch nothing more than the warmth of your wife sleeping next to you. Instead, the villager reaches the row of torchbearers a stone's throw away from you. A woman advances from the line and buries her dagger in his neck. The rest of your fellows shout. Rage, memory, and bloodthirsty triumph boil up in you. You all came with a purpose. You came to bring justice to the traitors of Cold Morn. The next few hours are painted in colors more vivid than life. You put your torch to anything that stands, and your sword to anyone who runs. It is as if Magrin herself whispers in your ear and guides your hand. Exhaustion has almost cooled your rage when you spy a house at the edge of town, one of the only buildings that hasn't already burned. It's flanked by knotty spruce trees, and the door is painted yellow. Yellow, the bloom of sunrise, the hue of your son's hair, the color of cowardice. Just then, someone barrels into you from behind. It's a man, someone you remember from your journey to Cold Morn, though you can't recall his name. He snarls at you, mad with indiscriminate rage, and it occurs to you that he's mistaken you for one of the villagers. You smash the window and hurl your torch inside. The other man has turned away. You think you hear a child's shriek within the house, but it's impossible to tell above the roar of the riot. Harmke shivers as you pull away from his memory. His eyes are wide with guilt and fear. Spit it out, Theodas. What do you see? The devil's feet are rooted in the snow, but her limbs jerk and tangle. He did it, though. Why would I say two would be a lie? I should say lie. She is the one with the yellow house, right? Is it not that simple? Either way, he did it to save his own skin in the end. He burned down your house. She stares at Harmke. You hear only a whirring mechanism in her throat, but Harmke leans closer.
What did you say?
His mouth quivers. What did it feel like? The torch in your hand, the blade you carried. What did they feel like? And did I misunderstand it? I mean, sometimes when I'm reading, I'm not really paying attention to so much as to what I'm reading, but that I'm reading it correctly. If she's the one with the yellow house, then yeah. I mean, he did it because somebody else, but he could have easily... It's not like I was about to be killed by the guy. The guy was just yelling at him. A wild, inhuman scream echoes out of the bizarre machinery in her throat. It drops Harmke and his companions to their knees, where they cry out in terror. Gears squeal and crank as she rushes at him. Alright, so I guess we're fighting them. Harmke and just a bunch of woodcutters. Try Withering Strike. Why not? These others shouldn't be much of a problem, but I shouldn't assume too much. I have no idea we still had ranged equipped here. Oh, I'm looking for Kana. Chain lightning to hit the others. Amplified wave. Do it off of the Devil of Caroc. Knock all these guys down.
What?
Oh, killed him already. Can you give us this in the middle? And Haravius. Zawa. Okay. Finishing blow. I'm not going to even use his spells. To slaughter. I hope I was right in that. I had a fast mode, I didn't even know.
I'll see what I can find.
Yeah, he did it, right? I looked into Harmka's soul and saw him torch the Devil of Caroc's house. I told her about it, and we killed him. Okay. For some reason I started doubting myself, thinking it wasn't as... That wasn't correct. She has something to say.
Almost 15 years I've been looking for him.
She stares ahead as you approach, the ink-black marbles of her eyes fixed on some distant point. Her essence swells and swirls in the throes of contemplation.
All that fretting and wondering. And the deed's over in less time than it takes to tell.
That's what she said. For number two. How do you feel now? She says nothing at first, and you hear only the dull clicking of something in her chest.
I killed a lot of folk in my time. Felt their blood slick in my hands, smelled their flesh as it burned.
She holds her hands in front of herself as they twitch in spasm.
And I always used to imagine what it would be like to have Harmke under my knife, feeling his breath come hot and fast, smelling the fear ooze out of him.
And?
Couldn't feel a thing. His fading pulse weren't no more than a powder of rain to me.
She shrugs, letting her arms clatter to her sides. What do you mean?
This body. It weren't made for feeling. Gouging my fingers into Harmka's wasting flesh, his screams just buzzing in my skull.
She flexes and unflexes her fingers in a few lightning-quick motions.
All it did was remind me.
Of what?
That this is a madman's fever dream. Like a prison. But no, because in a prison, you lay your head down and you feel the straw soft beneath you. Your flesh prickling in the cold, black bread crumbling on your tongue.
She turns her arms in front of her, examining the scrollwork on the backs of her hands with horror and wonder. This is the only answer I have to give. None of the others fit at all. Because the writing is so... so good in this game. So good that I just... Either that or I have a really good imagination and they're just hitting it just right. You're right. That sounds awful.
I still dream I'm folk. I wake up some mornings wondering why I can't feel the floor beneath me. Thinking I must have fallen and gone crippled. But then I lift my head. See a bronze corpse stretching out in front of me.
She lowers her head. A tremor runs through her. I'm sorry you have to go through that.
It's not pity I want, it's a choice.
She draws back from you. I can't give you that choice.
I dream too of what Galvino did that night. Those moments. I'd endure another cold morn if it had spared me this fate.
She rubs her hands together, tracing her even joints with her fingertips. What happened exactly?
It was after I got caught in Stalwart. They'd locked me in a little house by me and the old mare and his cronies.
Her head dips as she remembers.
When a crowd of them came for me in the dark of night, I was only surprised it had taken them so long.
She hesitates.
Only they didn't march me to no gallows. They snuck me to another house on the edge of town, real sneaky-like. That's where I met Galvino.
She raises her head, her black eyes shining. What was he doing there?
He was fiddling with some machinery in his workshop. Had his sleeves rolled up even though it was cold enough to see her breath. Never actually looked at me until he started fitting some copper helmet over my head. By that time, the mayor's goons had me trussed up good and tight. Galvino was having himself a grand time barking orders at that lot.
What did the mayor have to do with us?
He had agreed to hand me over to Galvino for an experiment.
She waves her hands at the word, metal flashing.
Claimed it was a fair punishment, but the town folk weren't too pleased at being denied their stone pitching.
She crosses her arms, nodding.
Didn't help that they heard the jangle of copper in that deal. In the end, that's what sent Galvino and the old mare packing.
I see.
So while Galvino's fastening that helmet over my head and them copper bands around my arms, I'm starting to look at his contraption. And that's when I see it.
Her black eyes are fixed on some indefinable point. Her essence dims.
It's this metal suit strapped into the machine, just like me. A cold, dead-eyed thing, all done up with fancy carvings and such.
She shivers, her joints chittering. Did you know what they intended?
I had this terrible cold feeling in my gut, but I still couldn't figure.
She shakes her head.
I start asking Galvino and the rest of them what's going on, but they're too busy to answer. Then suddenly, they're waiting, staring at me with that fixed, horrified look. But they ain't watching me. They're watching for something to happen.
Her eyes flicker, rolling and scraping behind her face.
Galvino tells the woman nearest the machine to flip the handle. And then, just pain. Being torn apart every which way, feeling my soul peeled from my body.
Her limbs twitch and shudder. She pauses, waiting for her body to fall still.
By the time I came to, I couldn't feel a thing. Just this dull, distant sort of ache.
Oops. I heard the old man cackling and chattering. When I saw him looming over me, looking down at me with hungry eyes, I tried to scream, tried to swing at him.
I think that was when I knew.
She shakes her head and falls silent. How could anyone put another person through something so terrible?
I reckon I'm the wrong person for that sort of question. But if it cools your conscience, Galvino didn't get off easy. The rest of Stalwart didn't take kindly to having a killer in their midst, nor to seeing their mayor and the army Valians strike a secret deal. They drove Galvino out, destroyed a fortune in machinery, and wrote a letter to the Academy in Salona, ruining what was left of his name. Still, he's lucky he didn't get a pelting. The old mayor fled too, and Stalwart's been as snug and cheery as ever.
Now that we've dealt with Harmke, why have you stuck around? I mean, I know it's only been like 5 minutes.
You're better company than Galvino.
She says it in an offhand, teasing fashion, but she looks away from you, fidgeting with a rivet.
Been a while since I were out in the world. Guess I'm keen on seeing more of it. Even if I'm stuck with a bleeding heart.
What?
Anyways, I've been wondering about that fortress.
She looks away again, flexing a wrist joint. You're acting unusually coy. She's quiet, fixated on her squeaking joint.
Near everyone thinks it'll have just the thing they need.
She ticks a list off on her clicking fingers.
Those villagers thought it'd fix up their broke-down town. Until you gave them bigger worries. Galvino always thought it carried some great secret of Animanson. And all them adventurers came looking for fancy gear.
And what were you hoping to find?
I don't know. Something to help me feel. Or forget. Effigy's eyes. Maybe just something new.
The tips of her metal fingers clack together.
I just figured, with those dwarves being expert smiths and all, maybe they had something to unmake me. Put me back into my body.
That's exactly what I was thinking as she was saying it. I doubt that's possible. Your body's decayed by now.
I know. It were just a passing fancy.
She turns away, her essence buzzing with agitation. I wanted to ask you something. No, I didn't. I wonder if anyone else has something to say here.
Yes?
He just talks about theirs.
Hey. What's on your mind?
If doubts and curiosity plague you...
Not today, Durrance.
I'm ready. Need something?
I'd like to have their opinion on...
Right here.
The Devil of Caroc. Okay. I know this is going to be a shorter episode, but it seems like a good place to wrap it up. We've wrapped up, at least for the most part, the Devil of Caroc's quest. Perhaps it continues within Durgan's battery itself. I am going to look for the other bounty in this region. And there might be a mistake that might wipe the floor with us, since they are stronger than the other two that I mentioned. But let's see. Thanks for watching. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.